As I've talked about before, fluency is so much more than how many answers kids can get in a minute. It includes being fast, yes. It includes being accurate, getting it correct, but it also includes kids being flexible. Yet most of the assessments that we use for fact fluency only assess how fast kids are and how accurate they are. So how do we assess for all three parts? Well, I'm Christina Tonnevold, the recovering traditionalist, and today I want to talk to you about math running records. Now, first, I want to give you a brief overview for those who may not have seen this before, the three key pieces to fluency and the CGI stages that kids go through as they're developing their facts. So the first thing is fluency. I personally love Susan Jo Russell's definition of fluency because it's simple, concise, and it's what I talked about in the beginning. They need accuracy, they need efficiency, but they also need flexibility. Basically, that also is seen in the CGI stages. That CGI stands for cognitively guided instruction. The research of cognitively guided instruction showed us that as kids are developing their strategies for addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, they will fall into these four stages. And sometimes they're in between stages. They'll be in one stage for one type of problem and another stage for another type of problem. But basically it boils down to these four stages. There's direct modeling, which is when a kid has to model every single piece of the problem. So for addition, that looks like 3 plus 4, where they'll count out 3, they'll count out 4, and then they have to come back and count everything all over again to figure out the total. This also happens in multiplication. If a child is doing 3 times 4, they will make 3 groups of 4, whether they draw it out, they use manipulatives, and then they come back and count every single thing that they drew or every single thing that they counted. Once kids start moving out of that stage, they'll move into the counting phase. For addition, the 3 plus 4, that's a kid who holds the 3 in their head and then counts on 4 more. Now, they might get to the phase where they hold the 4 in their head and then count on 3 more. For multiplication, this tends to look like skip counting. If I'm doing 3 times 4, they will skip count 4 3 times. Now, what's hard is that once kids get to that phase, we tend to jump them straight to just learn it, know it, memorize it. And we start quizzing kids with flashcards and time tests to hopefully get them faster and more accurate. However, if they don't know it, they fall all the way back down to that counting phase. So the in-between phase is really where that flexibility that Susan Jo Russell talked about comes into play. The in-between phase is called derived facts. This is where kids are using something that they know to help them with something they don't know. So for the 3 plus 4 example, that's a kid who might say something like, well, 3 plus 3 is 6, and so 1 more gives me 7. For a kid who's doing the multiplication of 3 times 4, they may know that 2 times 4 is 8, and they just need 1 more 4 to help them out. Okay, so it's using something they know to help them with something they don't know. And that's really what flexibility is all about. But how do we assess that? Well, I have become a big fan of Dr. Nikki Newton's math running records. So basically, there are 3 parts to math running records. You first just start out with giving kids the list of problems, and they are picked on purpose. So you can download below the one for addition and the one for multiplication, but there are specific problems that are given because we're going to use that in a moment. But you just give them the problems and you're assessing, are they automatic, which you circle A. If it took around 5 seconds, then you circle the 5S. If it was prolonged thinking time, then you would circle the PTH. For prolonged thinking time. Now, once they've actually done that piece and they're just giving you the answers, the next stage of a running record is to then question them about the types of strategies they have for the types of problems. So in the first part, you'll see where the first problem is +0 for the addition one. Well, then you're asking them about a strategy and what they know about what happens for plus zero. And then you're going on, like there's ones for doubles. Do they understand doubles? Do they understand doubles plus one, right? So you can go through this questioning piece. Now here's the part where I fudge it a little bit, because if I notice that in the first part, they are sitting there counting on their fingers, in the next part where I'm questioning and asking them about strategies, I'll ask the first couple, but if they don't have strategies for those first few, and if I didn't see them using strategies, I just saw them counting on their fingers for every single problem, then I'm not going to take the time and ask them every single one of those types of strategies. I'm just going to mark it down as they did not have flexibility because I didn't see them using it, right? So if they are showing some flexibility, or I couldn't tell how they solved it, they just gave me an answer, then I really am using that second piece of questioning. When you're solving a problem like this, do you have a strategy for that? What do you do when you're adding something to 10? Is there something you know about adding to 10, right? You want to dig a little bit to find out about their strategies, and that's you're looking at their flexibility. Same is true for multiplication. There are certain types of facts that lead into strategies, right? Kids should be using times two to help them with times fours. That's a great strategy. But if they're sitting there doing skip counting, they're not using strategies. So you can kind of not go through all of the questions if you notice that the kids aren't using strategies. You can cut that piece short. Now, the second piece of it was some questions about the disposition that they have around mathematics and around like their growth mindset a little bit. Now, if you have time, these are really, really great questions to be asking the kids to get a little bit more insight into how they view mathematics. But personally, like when I'm trying to do an assessment on a class of 25 kids, sometimes I don't have the amount of time to be able to do the full piece. So the third part about the questions about disposition, I found was sometimes optional. If you ask Dr. Nikki, she will probably say it is not optional, but reality is sometimes we have to make decisions. And when I was doing it, I made the decision not to always ask about disposition. I did on a few because it is kind of interesting to see what they say, right? Like, look at this one. She says, yes, I'm a fan of math, but it's hard, right? That was pretty fun to see. So some of those, it's really cool to see those insights of how kids think about mathematics. But again, I kind of found it could be optional if you don't have time to get through those pieces. Now, the last thing I'd like to talk to you about is why you should be doing running records. One of the things that I found really interesting, beginning of this school year, I used the addition running record with a group of third graders because I knew they were jumping straight into multiplication. And if kids really aren't solid with addition and have strategies around addition, it can really impact their ability to make sense of multiplication and to become fluent with multiplication. They can make sense of what multiplication is, but to develop their fluency, it really does help if they are fluent with addition and even with subtraction too. Right. So I wanted to test that out. And one of the things that I found very interesting was that there were definitely kids who got them all correct, but they had no strategies. So there were kids who just knew them, but had no strategies when I got to the second part of the assessment. There were kids who got them all correct, but their only strategy was just counting on their fingers. So they got them correct, but they were slow. Their efficiency was really low. Now, the other thing that I saw that was very interesting was that speed does not tell me that they had it. So if you take a look at this piece, the scoring down at the bottom, her speed was not that great. She was kind of slow, right? She was mainly in the, it took 5 seconds. She had prolonged thinking time on some. Some of them she scored automatic, the A's. So I put her at a 1.5. But the cool part was she was very accurate. She got all of them correct, but her flexibility was the coolest part. When I went to the second part, she had strategies for every single one of those problems. The hard part was She just wasn't fast with those strategies yet. They weren't automatic. She knew how to make 10. She knew how to use doubles to help her out, but she wasn't quick with them. Now, on a normal timed test, that child right there and this child would probably score the same. Their speed was about the same. It took them a little longer to solve the problems, but they got them all right every single time. The difference was in their flexibility. When I asked this child about their strategies, they had none. It was all counting. So on a time test, you don't know the strategies your kids are using. All you see is the end result, how many they got right in that minute, but it's not telling you how they're approaching the problem. So if you're using those assessments to then determine this kid needs some extra work, they need some intervention, personally, this child right here is not in need of intervention. They just need more practice to become more fluent and become a little bit faster. They've got the strategies. They have the number sense. They have the connections made. They just need to become more fluent with it through developing their speed a little bit more. Whereas the other child needs to develop a whole lot more number sense and understanding around addition in order to become more flexible, and then their speed will increase. One of the cool things that I saw was that every kid who had high speed also had high flexibility. I did not see any kids who had really high speed but low flexibility in this classroom. I'm sure that sometimes that happens, but in this classroom, that was not the case when I was doing assessments. The only kids who had high speed were kids who had high flexibility. They had strategies. They weren't just relying upon their fingers, and they weren't just relying upon that they knew it. It wasn't just memorized. So I want to encourage you to try out running records, whether it's for addition or multiplication. I would definitely start with one of those. Subtraction and division would come later after you've assessed addition and multiplication. So there's links below this video that will take you to the download for each one of those. And I'd like you to find a couple of your kiddos who maybe have that low flexibility that you would like to work with, because coming up, I have a free 5-day training on how to work with those kids using number talks to develop their fact fluency by building their number sense. So I'd really like you to try out the running records assessment, find a kid, maybe two, that you'd like to work with over 5 days. It's gonna be quick, 5-10 minute thing that you're gonna do with that child. And we're going to see how their fact fluency develops over just 5 days. So whether it's for addition, grab the stuff around addition. You can sign up for the free training below this video for the pre-K to second grade. We're going to work on building kids' number sense to develop their fact fluency through the use of number talks. And then there's also a link that if you're upper grades, we're going to be working on developing fact fluency for multiplication facts. So sign up for that one too. So check out the assessment, try it out with your kiddos, and get signed up for the free training so that once you've found those kids who need some help, I'm going to give you 5 days of instruction that you can help develop those strategies for the kiddos who are needing it. So I hope that this has helped you build your math minds so that you can go out there and build the math minds of your students.